The work known as the Magical Treatise of Solomon or Hygromanteia is a Greek magical book that survives in 14 manuscripts, the earliest of which dates to the 15th century. The book's importance lies in the fact that its material seems to have influenced at least one of the most widely known magical books of the West, The Key of Solomon. The known manuscripts that contain the magical treatise material are presented here by order of antiquity. The first two date from the 15th century, then 3 to 8 from the 16th, the next two from the 17th, 11 and 12 from 18th, and 13 and 14 from the 19th century. There used to be a 15th manuscript until 1904, when the National University Library of Turin was struck by fire. The quantity of their magical treatise material varies. Other manuscripts have just one section, and others have more or less complete text. But no manuscript is totally complete. Now, the title of the work survives in 5 manuscripts only, and in 3 different forms. The word Hygromanteia appears in the title of 2 manuscripts. The whole title is The Little Key of the Entire Art of Hygromanteia. Note that the phrase the little key is the English equivalent of the Latin clavicula, a term that sometimes is used to describe the text. 2 other manuscripts bear the title The Instruction of Solomon to His Son Rehoboam, and finally, in one manuscript, the title is Αποτελεσματική Πραγματεία, which is usually translated as The Magical Treatise. Occasionally, some scholars use the title Epistle to Rehoboam, but this is not supported by the manuscripts. And some Greek scholars often use the common Greek term Solomonική, which is just to say Solomonic. But this is based on Greek folklore. Hygromanteia is a word that means water divination. There are 3 theories that try to explain this title with regard to the content. Pablo Torrijano explains it by the possible loss of pages in an original manuscript that once contained an actual water divination spell before the treatise. Richard Greenfield, on the other hand, suggests that a water divination textbook may have been in existence prior to the 15th century, containing a ritual for summoning demons to a circle by means of a basin full of water. And eventually the basin will have been dropped out, and etc. Finally, Skinner and Rankin argue that the whole word Hygromanteia does not mean water divination in this context, but applies to the ancient practice of constraining demons in hydria, that is to say, water jars, a practice linked with Solomon in another Greek magical book, the Testament of Solomon. In any case, the treatise can be divided in 4 parts. The first part is related to the construction of talismans and their consecration by planetary powers. The second part pertains to evocation. All astrological information is ignored and the spirits are attributed to the 4 quarters. It is possible that the first part was originally a separate work placed before the evocation material. Now, the third part is simply a similar method of evocation that probably shares a common origin with the previous one. And then there is a miscellany of independent magical operations scattered through the manuscripts. This material seems to be older than the treatise and resembles somehow the Greek magical papyri. The first part begins with an introduction that consists of Solomon's exhortation to Rehoboam. This is usually followed by Rehoboam's question to Solomon regarding the virtue of things, and by Solomon's reply that the virtue of things lies in herbs, words, and stones. However, the text itself has little relevance to herbs, and the same remark apply to the stones, because there is no section on stones. So, this part of the introduction is certainly taken from a different text, maybe alone from the Hermetic text known as Asclepius. It's very similar. The introduction is followed by a section about the talismans that are attributed to the planetary hours of the 7 days of the week. The first hour of each day is attributed to the planet that rules the entire day. The day starts with sunrise, so the hour beginning with Sunday's sunrise belongs to the sun. The next hours are attributed in their turn to Venus, Mercury, the Moon, Saturn, Jupiter, and Mars. When the circle ends, the attributions start again from the sun, and so on. Next to each hour follow the effects one will cause if they construct a talisman during this specific hour. The logic of these talismans is often combinative. For instance, Venus is attributed to love affairs, while Saturn is considered unlucky. Thus, a talisman made during the fourth hour of Friday, with Venus as a ruler of the day and Saturn as a ruler of the hour, will prevent love between two persons. This section does not seem to have survived in posterior grimoires, but its philosophy does. It could be contended that it is the source of every grimoire that uses the planetary hours, the Key of Solomon included. After the section of the planetary hours, there is a series of 7 planetary prayers. In most cases, the instructions say that after one has found the desirable hour for one's purpose, they must recite the prayer of the planet that rules the day. These prayers are addressed to God, followed by the conjuration of the planets, which include some magical planetary names. In fact, there are 2 different series of planetary prayers in the manuscripts, a long and a short one. Some manuscripts use one, some the other. Some include both series. There are scholars who argue that the prayers are adapted from pagan sources, but it seems the planets are not the actual recipients of the prayers. There are natural forces conjured by the power of God. In some manuscripts, there are irrelevant sections with general information concerning the signs of the zodiac, the 29 days of the moon, the position of the moon in the zodiac, the caput and cauda draconis, etc. All this information is probably inserted at a later time from independent astrological works. In 2 manuscripts, the 2 Athenian manuscripts, there is a section that describes the construction and consecration of 7 metallic planetary images, either statuettes or engraved on sheets of metal. The proper time for their construction is the day and the hour when the appropriate planet rules, while the sun and the moon must be in the signs ruled by the same planet. The metals attributed to the planets are the usual ones, like sun gold, moon silver, etc., with the exception of mercury, which is attributed to cast bronze instead of quicksilver mercury. Before their construction, one must recite the planetary prayer and the conjuration of the angel and the demon. Then magical names are to be engraved upon the image with the knife of the art. And finally, it must be sensed with special incenses. This is the image of Mars. Okay. Then follows the conjuration of the angels. By the power of God, one conjures the angels who, in their turn, are asked to subdue the demons under the conjurer's will. The conjuration is the same in all cases, but the conjurer has to fill in the proper angelic and demonic names. After the conjuration, one can find either a long or a short list of angels and demons. The long list cites an angel and a demon attributed to each planetary hour of the week. This is Wednesday. The short list, on the other hand, attributes the angels and the demons not to the planetary hours, but to the planets generally. There seems to be a distant relationship between the two lists, since the main angelic names are the same. Regarding their origin, few things can be said. In their vast majority, they do not appear in other sources, with the exception of six demons that come from the Testament of Solomon. The name of the chief demon of Wednesday, where the A is, Lucifer, is one of the key elements for dating the treatise. It is the Italian pronunciation of Lucifer. A Greek of the early Middle Ages would never use the Latin name, since a Greek equivalent, Theosphoros, had been long used. It should be noted that the Italian influence is also evident in the vocabulary of other parts of the treatise. For this reason, I believe that the Hygromanteia was composed in Crete during the 13th century, that is to say, under Venetian rule. Of course, other theories do exist. The next section contains instructions on the manufacture of seven composite incenses, one for each planet. Every planetary incense is followed by the planetary characters intended to be written on the talismans, and then follows a seal, one for each planet again. Since there is another section later, which presents a different series of planetary characters and incenses, as well as parchments and inks, I believe that this section belongs to a different talismanic tradition that originally did not use parchment for the talismans, but wax, clay, or even metal. Four manuscripts also contain a section on planetary alphabets that resemble the Hebrew magical alphabets named Celestial, Malachim, and Transitus Fluvii, the passage of the river. There are four instead of seven alphabets, though, since two planets can share one alphabet. Thus, Mars and Saturn share the same alphabet, Venus and the Moon another, Mercury and the Sun a third. Interestingly, Jupiter has his own alphabet. According to the text, one must write their purpose on the talisman using the appropriate alphabet. I believe that the alphabets initially were not of a planetary nature, and that this section is a later intrusion. As Hebrew and Greek magical alphabets first appear in the 16th century. Then follows a section that describes a series of seven planetary inks, seven kinds of parchment, seven planetary characters, different from the previous ones, and seven simple incenses for the consecration of the talismans, again different from the previous ones. The attributions of incenses to the planets do not resemble any other attributions found in other magical books. However, the present section can explain why the seal of God in the sworn book of Honorius, another magical text, has to be drawn on calf, foal, or fawn parchment. Because according to the magical treatise, these three are the parchments dedicated to Jupiter, the Sun, and Venus, respectively. That is to say, the three beneficial planets. In some manuscripts, there are sections concerning the magical and medical virtues of herbs attributed to the 12 signs of the zodiac and to the seven planets. Generally, in the Greek manuscripts, there are four independent planetary herbaria. The first is falsely attributed to Alexander the Great and survives in the Book of Secrets of Albertus Magnus and also in the occult philosophy of Cornelius Agrippa. The second appears again in Agrippa's occult philosophy. A characteristic of the third herbarium is the tradition regarding the herb of the sun, which is called Avgia, the sign herb, which is not possible to be found except at night, according to the lore, when it shines brightly. This is a very old tradition that can be found in first century sources, in the works of Josephus. Finally, the fourth work is a variation of the third. Then follows a section about the knife of the art. With this knife, the sorcerer has to slaughter and skin the animals in order to make parchment or to collect their blood for the inks. Moreover, he has to cut and point the pens with it. The blade of the knife must be from iron that has brought death, but the handle must be made from the horn of a black he-goat. Four manuscripts refer to certain barbarous names that have to be written on the knife, and according to them, it must be constructed at the day and the hour of Mars. This is my own. Traditions concerning the black-handled knife and its magical connections still survive in Greece, mainly in Crete, where such knives with handles made of black he-goat horns are still manufactured. Nikolaos Politis, a folklorist in Greece, cites a tradition from Crete in 1904. It reads, "If somebody wants to learn how to play well the Cretan lyra, he goes at midnight to a deserted crossroad. He traces a circle on the ground with a black-handled knife, enters the circle, sits down and plays. Moments later, fairies come from every direction and surround him. They do not have good intentions. They want to harm him. but they cannot enter the circle since it is traced with a black-handled knife. So they try to seduce him and draw him out. The construction of the black-handled knife is described in the Key of Solomon, but it's different from the process mentioned in the Greek text. The construction of a knife of the knife of the art is also described in the Grimorium Verum, but there is no description of it as black-handled. However, the latter work instructs that it must be made at the day and the hour of Mars, following the tradition of the four magical treatise manuscripts mentioned above. Immediately after the section about the knife follows the one about the reed pen or pens of the art. Some manuscripts speak of one pen and some of seven, one for each planet. A reed must be cut with a single stroke by means of the knife of the art. As he strikes, the sorcerer must be on his knees and also recite a short prayer. This reed pen has a parallel in Sefer Raziel. Here the pen must be made from a green reed instead of a dry one, but it must be cut with a single stroke as well. Closely connected with the previous section is the one regarding the quill of the art. According to some manuscripts, the quill must be constructed from a goose feather, while others allow it to be made also from a crow, vulture, or another bird. When one plucks it, they must recite a short prayer. Then it has to be pointed by means of the knife of the art and washed in running water. Similar but not identical instructions are given both in the Key of Solomon and the Grimorium Verum. The next section gives instruction about the manufacture of the virgin parchment. Its source must be a suckling male animal. This animal must be slain by means of the knife of the art while reciting a short prayer. It is then to be flayed and its skin to be washed in running water and left under the sun to dry. Finally, it is to be worked with quicklime. Similar procedures are followed by the Key of Solomon and the Grimorium Verum again. Then follow instructions about the blood of various animals, such as a bat, a swallow, a dove, and an ox. All of them are to be slain by means of the knife of the art, while the sorcerer recites a short prayer. As regards the blood of the bat and of the ox, it is an expansion of the section concerning the inks, where the blood of the bat is mentioned as the ink of Venus and the blood of an ox as the ink of Mercury. The references to the swallow and the dove are probably later additions. Again, similar instructions appear in the Key of Solomon. However, there is no explanation concerning its use in the Key of Solomon. Note also that in the Sworn Book of Honorius, the blood of the bat is one of the alternatives for the ink used to draw the seal of God. The sections about the virgin wax and the virgin clay may be intrusions from other magical texts because their use is not explained. The virgin wax has to be collected from a beehive and placed in the sanctuary of a church in order to be consecrated. When the sorcerer wants to fashion something, he has to recite a certain prayer. A similar chapter again can be found in the Key of Solomon, but again, no explanation is included. As I said before, the second part is a method for the evocation of the spirits of the four parts of the world. It begins with a section about the moral rules that an evoker must follow. It also mentions a confession and the bath, after which the ritual apparel is described. There is an outer robe, an inner tunic, a cloak, stockings, all of which have to be new, white, and linen. Afterwards, the text mentions a three-day fast of bread and water, and concludes with the signs that have to be written on the collar of the outer robe and on the stockings. Parallels of this section can be found in both the Key of Solomon and in the Grimorium Verum. The evoker's accessories also include a crown, a kind of headdress made from virgin parchment. The Key of Solomon also describes a similar crown. Then the text introduces us to the lamen, which is called Urania, a word that remains untranslated by scholars. The word can be translated as the heavenly one, and in all probability is a shortened version of Urania's phragis, meaning the heavenly seal or sigil. This seal is believed to protect the evoker and to give him power over the spirits. The lamen is to cover the front part of his body from chest to the waist. This seal is believed to It is to be made from calf parchment, whereupon 10 talismans have to be drawn, as you see there. The seal as a major instrument of evocation is commonplace in grimoires, and different lamens appear in the Sworn Book of Honorius, the Heptameron, the Goetia, and some versions of the Key of Solomon. The ring is also a very important element in the treatise. This is made from virgin wax and covered by virgin parchment, whereupon various barbarous names must be written. But wearing a wax ring is a very peculiar idea. So one manuscript transmutes to a totally different ring made from cast silver. This section is of course influenced by the Testament of Solomon, where Solomon's ring appears to be the major instrument of the art. The inscriptions of the ring now in the Testament and the Magical Treatise are very similar and can be also found independently in talismans like this one, or divination techniques. In any case, the ring and its inscription seem to predate the treatise. The following section describes the proper places for the evocation as well as the proper time, that is to say the full moon. And then the evoker has to trace two concentric circles with magical names by means of the knife of the art. The circle is to be enclosed within two squares with the angles of the inner one touching the centers of the sides of the outer. The entrance here must be towards the south, and before entering the circle, the apprentice must ring a special bell. When the evoker and his apprentice finally enter the circle, the entrance is sealed with the knife of the art. Parallels of this section, as well as the drawing of the circle, have been preserved in the Key of Solomon. Then follows a prayer and three conjurations for the appearance of the spirits. The first conjuration is addressed to 12 demons in order to appear in visible form. Part of this conjuration is related to the third conjuration of the Key of Solomon. Then the evoker is expected to see clouds arising, and this is the time to recite a short second conjuration in order to make the spirits appear in a human and not in a monstrous form. The third conjuration is used only if the demons delay to approach him and the targets of the four kings of the quarters, and targets the four kings of the quarters. A legion of demons is then to appear, and he must make them swear obedience. After the vow is given, the evoker's demands can be of two kinds: demands for love and sex, and demands for money. The two things people want. In each case, the evoker postulates them in the form of a long fourth conjuration, and this marks the end of the first method of evocation. Now, the third part of the magical treatise describes another method of evocation similar to the first one, but somehow easier. The prerequisites are sexual abstinence for 2 weeks, a kind of fast for the same period, and 3 days of strict fasting with water and bread. The clothes are just a white linen tunic, stockings, and shoes. Instead of a crown made from virgin parchment, there is a piece of cloth like a turban, whereupon certain names are to be written. Finally, the lamen is constructed with unborn calf parchment, like the one in the first method. But the design is totally different. This time contains 24 independent circular seals and a series of names. The instructions for the proper place and time are the same as in the first method. After the bath, the evoker must be anointed with a special scented oil. He must sense the garments with frankincense, put them on, trace the circle with the knife of the art, and place a special incense on 4 braziers. The image of the circle resembles the one of the previous procedure, but this time the double circle is enclosed within 1 square only. This figure also survives in the Key of Solomon. The Key of Solomon has 2 variations of the circles, both of which are from the Byzantine manuscripts. The next section contains 4 short conjurations to be recited towards the four quarters. The main part of them are the names of the 30 demons attributed to each quarter, followed by a kind of a simple order like, come, 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 do not delay, but come, wherever you may be. The four kings are Lucifer, king of the east, Beelzebul, like Beelzebub, king of the south, Astaroth, king of the west, and Asmodai, king of the north. Concerning the survival of the 4 demon kings in the Grimorium Verum, we can see that only Asmodai is missing. But the kings of the quarters become solidified into continents there. Thus, Lucifer rules in Europe and Asia, Beelzebub in Africa, and Astaroth in America. The same remarks apply also to the Grand Grimoire. And finally, in the book of Abramelin, Lucifer remains a king, but the other 3 are regarded among the 8 dukes. The third part ends with a general conjuration towards the spirits. After the evoker has pronounced the names of the demons, he conjures them by the holy names of God in order to appear before him in a beautiful human form and obey his will. After this, he is expected to see the demons as an army. He must welcome them and then ask them for what he wants. One manuscript also cites a license to depart. And with this, the contents of the magical treatise are covered. Unfortunately, time does not allow me to expand on the independent magical operations that are present in the manuscripts. And I would be more than happy to answer any questions you may have. Please do not ask me if the demons indeed come after you do all this stuff. Thank you.